Welcome. Thanks for organizing this the way you did it, actually, under uncertainty. This is not easy, I think. I think actually we have to thank you and not the other way around. So, you know, actually there were talks that have been cancelled, and one of them was a talk that I was going to attend at this school. This was called the Swiss Crypto Day. And it was cancelled. Last year, this day, this crypto day, was held at the University of Bern. And, you know, the usual suspects, like people from EPFL, from this school, from other universities. And Professor Uli Maurer, he's actually known in cryptography, I think. When he started his talk, he was saying something along the line that people may have come to the wrong event. You know, actually referring to crypto being used for all kinds of things, like cryptocurrencies and stuff like that, rather than cryptography. So perhaps he was looking at me, I don't know. As you know, there are at least two people in this country by the name of Uli Maurer who like to talk about crypto every now and then, and probably this one who knows a little bit more about cryptography than the other one, but do I dare to say more or compare those two? Of course not. So this talk is not primarily about fitness trackers and stuff like that, but you know, when you say it's not about this, but then it's always dangerous. First, I want to introduce you to a study which is quite interesting. You know, I'm from Bern, I know what you're thinking, but I have to prove that this talk is quite fast. So hold your breath. And you know, actually, during my studies, there was an instructor who favored very fast slide changes. Actually, he said that you've got to change your slides every 5 or 10 seconds, which would mean I would have to have 500 plus slides. I'm not there yet, but you've been warned. So, again, this is probably a strange question, but this talk is about tracking after all. So we might ask, well, why do some health insurance actually give discounts when using a fitness tracker? Did you know that some health insurances do that? For those who are not residents in this country, in Switzerland, we do have some compulsory basic insurance, as you may or may not know. So we might do this when you have a health insurance with tracking benefits. This is an old movie. I don't even know if that works today, but don't do this at home. It might be illegal if you have an insurance like that. So perhaps this is the reason why I found this quite interesting, but I checked some research, and research seems to say that there is no connection between fitness trackers and better health, actually. But insurances might ask effectiveness questions, efficiency questions, because better health might be actually too vague. So what is effectiveness? Of course, you've heard in secondary school, teachers like to cite Peter Drucker, which is okay, but they often forget that he also said this: efficiency is not everything. So back to insurances, they might consider physical health is actually, physical exercise is actually healthier, and they might talk about costs. So let's look at this. Of course, you know, correlation and causation is a problem if we talk about evaluating something. So they would perhaps say fitness is healthy, but actually the problem is, do trackers make fitness more healthy? Or if you already do have a tracking machine and not a fake one, then you might take out this insurance, of course, because you get some discounts. And cost savings for whom? Well, if the insurance has to pay you some discounts, actually the insurance loses money, sort of, and the insured person wins. So what's the conclusion here? Actually, the insurance does lose money. That's basics, right? That's what we learned in secondary school. unless they do have a positive marginal income, right? What do we know about the national economy view? Well, actually, premiums might go up if the health effect is uncertain, which it is. You know, overall, people might use trackers who already do use trackers. So this is uncertain, but I'm just pointing this out. So, you know, think Shakespeare's reward trackers or not reward trackers, trackers or not trackers, that's the question, really. We have to look at the delta, and the reality is often fuzzy. Exercise is healthy, being healthy saves costs, etc. So, now this last sentence, well, this is always complicated sentences, but this actually says that technology, well, this is perhaps an economic view, technology is best when it can be applied directly to what the task is supposed to be. And that improves actually effectiveness and efficiency. So, you know, I could stop here before I really begin, because these things you'll have to find out will be used later in this talk. Now, you've read this, I'll go over this, but the project I'm actually working with is not my day-to-day job, but it was actually an idea some years ago. You know, some business people with some IT or economic background, they tried to find out if we could actually put research or translate research into jobs, into business, into, you know, explaining to interested parties. So there are all kinds of themes like security, privacy, digital economics, etc. And of course, if you're interested, you might try to join mailing list or something like that. There is actually a draft for comments now new, but there is nothing yet there, so well, this is supposed to be a system to comment on some text we might have. Talking about economics, for this talk, I think we can do with an easy thing like economics equals behavior, choices, decisions, and so this is just to avoid a little bit this stereotype of economics, or what is digital economics. So we've had this example. I've go to the next point, and this is a story I was actually going to drop, and I'm going very fast, actually. You know, it was conceived in 2019, and you may not find it funny after all, but sit back and relax, maybe not too much, because after all, people get killed. There was an outbreak of smallpox in Birmingham in 1966, and you know, the university there had a smallpox research laboratory, so it was clear or assumed that the leak was from there. Smallpox, you're not really supposed to know what this is, because in 1980, WHO declared smallpox as eradicated. It's actually the only infectious disease ever to achieve this distinction, according to the WHO. And in case you speak some other languages, that's what we know. And actually, Mr. Ramses, some 3,000 years ago, is believed to have been a victim of smallpox. So the difference between the outbreak of 1966 and 1978 is actually variola minor, as you see on the top, and variola major, which is much more dangerous. And we do know from 1978 who the photographer was of this university, Mrs. James Parker. That's what apparently happened. You know, some people got really shocked or had some panic. Some people had to be quarantined. I think we know in the meantime what that could mean. And Janet Parker, the first case, actually died, and the ward was sealed. Now, the professor who was responsible for this research lab, he actually killed himself. The father of Mrs. Parker apparently died when he saw his dying daughter from a heart attack. So there were actually three people dead, and there was an investigation done by the parliament. You know, things like particle dispersal was tested, or contact tracing was done. This is actually the case from 1966. You know, you don't have to read it. Location, who got infected by whom, all nicely done. And actually, you should know this. Contact tracing looks the same today from top to down. It's quite impressive, I think, how viruses develop or can develop. It's quite scary that in the fifth generation, you know, the virus can spread already quite a bit. And this, ask your favorite epidemiologist, because I don't know, but you can tell that influenza is easier, it's not as easy to track or to trace as is, for example, smallpox, fortunately, in this case. Now, I'd say, you know, since I put this in my description of the talk, I would think that tracing is something like looking back and going back to the future, whereas tracking is probably a bit more following pursue or note the progress. So I don't think it matters a lot. We talk about contact tracing, but I think it's fair to use those interchangeably. Now, of course, we know that digital tracing technology is rather new. I found a talk like 2018. We, of course, know DP3T. Please do watch Kenny Patterson if you haven't done already. It's quite interesting, actually. I think it's a very interesting research project. The problem is effectiveness. Actually, from our project, we thought that there would be between 0 and 20 cases within 3 months. The official number was 13 cases. Well, no one to blame, really. It's still interesting. I'm glad I did it. Ebola is another tracing application, also very interesting. But here again, remember the marginal view we have to make. So nobody claims, or this paper doesn't claim, to have saved some people contracting Ebola in 2015. But it did improve data completeness, for example. So we've done that. Let's move forward to tracking in general. Of course, you know that tracking can be used unbiased. It's actually a neutral word. We all know tracking examples, eye tracking, for example. I did that once in a research lab. It's quite interesting, actually. And don't read this list. It's incomplete. But just to give you an idea that, of course, we do know about many tracking examples. And I'll focus a little bit on internet tracking. I don't find the definition of tracking in research papers, not in many papers, actually. So I propose, for simplicity, follow a person is actually what tracking is, and profiling is obviously doing a behavioral analysis, right? So the unofficial or often not admitted point here is that they really want to know who you are and assign data to you. According to these guys from Princeton, the web, we could add app, etc., all this internet stuff. Problem of tracking is actually a transparency problem. So let's look at some examples. Of course, you're well informed, so you know these things. Some people do get commercial mails if they, or newsletters if they want to. When opening mails, this research is actually 3 or 2 years old. Says that 70% contain resources that would have to be categorized as trackers. And what some people don't know, that about a third does leak your email address to the tracking company, which is another company than the one that sends you a newsletter, of course. And the funny thing is that when reopening an email, that often brings in new third parties, which is a bit funny. Now, this is a mail, well, it's a part of a mail from Mr. Zuckerberg. And you know, this of course, this image box that wasn't seen as an image does probably have some tracking link. I don't know, there are many other things in here, like for example, the email address, which doesn't matter in this case because Facebook already knows my or your email address, of course. Now, to the next point, recipients, when they click links, that you know too, but I'm surprised to hear that people don't know this. Well, obviously submitting tracking identification to the tracking company, actually a third-party company. And also here again, one-third does leak email addresses. This is an example of a mail, looks nice, doesn't it? Of course, it looks this way when you do look at mails with plain text enabled, which is a good idea, actually. But what does the average user say? Do they know, for example, that your emails can be tracked, can be correlated with web tracking? That's what these guys say, actually. You don't have to read everything, but they claim that, you know, they on the top left, they talk about webmail, but it probably doesn't matter. And the email is in the link of the tracking company. And if you look up a website, obviously you get tracked both ways. Let's look at cookies. You all know what cookies are, right? Just pointing out, look in your storage inspector. There are other things like local storage also. I think most browsers actually do have something like that. But if you're like me, you find it funny. This is actually a renowned company. I won't say which one unless you see it. Talking about small text files, of course, cookies are not small text files. But my point here is, why should we be interested in an implementation detail? So some other definitions have been proposed, like the second one. You can tell it's a software engineer. She actually has a funny homepage, by the way. And another myth, well, it depends really. Are cookies always harmless? Some of you might remember the Belgicom case, which in my view isn't possible today the way they did it, because with TLS I don't think it would work. But anyway, that's what this guy said. Could be quite valuable depending on how you look at it. Now, session replay is another thing. Do people really expect that keystrokes can be observed already before you send off a form? Let's look at this Princeton script. It's actually an example script. You know that JavaScript can do that. You don't have to read it. It's just somebody on your left entering some information, and on the right there is a dashboard by some operator. Probably it's just somehow saved to the database, I don't know. And things already appear to the tracker or to the party where you entered your data before you actually send it off. And that's probably most average people don't expect that. Of course, you can turn off JavaScript and probably nothing works as it's supposed to. But yeah, that's about session replay. There are many other things. I will go to the third-party tracking in general. And I think this is really the most important or most frequent thing. Obviously, it's not connecting to website, but it's connecting you if you visit A or website B like this. Now, this is not my image, but it actually claims that if you visit, for example, two e-commerce sites, then this is the graph that you get. It's quite impressive, you know, how many interconnections, how many connections there are made by just visiting two websites. And this red little triangle up there is supposed to be a real-time advertising broker. Now here, if you use uBlock Origin, which I hope you do in your browser, you can see perhaps that domains are listed. This list could go on, and here it actually says that 97% have been blocked, although this is because the way this extension is set. I think mobile OS or browser, anything works in this same way. Now, what is associated with third-party tracking? We've already said real-time bidding is the big thing, and psychological targeting. I think I wouldn't say that all those things are the same, but they look similar. So I'll go a bit faster. My point here is a bit that we probably don't know. Well, we do know, but do we really understand? You know, this is an often seen graph, or this is a newer one. Do we really understand this exponential random graph models? I'm not a mathematician, but do we fully understand what's going on? I think it's more a brain stuff. Of course, we do know, but to your left, you remember the smallpox graph and all the other things. I claim that those all work the same way, basically. So I'll go a bit faster. Manipulation part, that's actually my last point, really, almost. And I think we know that manipulation is something like influence and control, perhaps. Violation of the target's autonomy, that's something that is often stated. And knowing puts the knower in a position to exercise considerable influence. Now, this sense is perhaps known not this way, but it's known generally, I believe. And actually, weaknesses and vulnerabilities can be used. I'll go over this and look at some privacy concepts, which are in most any constitution. It's a human rights, ECHR. We know that, of course. And I think data protection, in my opinion, is a bit more a theoretical concept. People don't often get what it really means. So perhaps privacy is a better word for this. And we know that not everyone is the same. So make no mistake, autocratic thinking is not funny, really. It's actually somebody else decides or wants control over you. So there are some schools of thought, of course there are many, which I find interesting. Let's just look at this, and this is a Eurocentric business view, so to speak, from a journal called The Economist. And they actually say that it gives or it helps competition, which might be good for Europe, and they even say it could boost the economy. If people do have control, or consumer does have control, it boosts choice and raises standards, but it also has risks, according to them. Then there is another view, for example, like this one. It's always good to talk about challenges. But they actually say, it's quite interesting, how the data are being used is what matters most, and not necessarily who collects data. I find that interesting. And they actually say that there should be some regulation about psychological targeting. I don't know how that would work. Privacy by design, of course, we do know that. And default privacy setting or privacy setting would burden or lift the burden from users. Now, why do actually some former Silicon Valley employees talk in such alarming ways, like democracy at risk, etc.? I think, well, this is an old one. I think it has been around since the 1990s. I think the answer really is they do know what they're talking about, right? And one guy says, Tristan Harris is quite well-known former Google employee, he says that even if we did manage to solve the privacy issue, actually we don't solve much. Troubling trends still continue. Teenagers would remain vulnerable, etc. So that's his view. So being a business, I continue fast and want to know, well, how effective is actually psychological targeting, to just mention an example. Now, if you look at this by a talk by a young researcher, she says that, 50% more purchases. The first thing I don't know if you see it, but it's probably from something like, let's say, 8 to 16 per 100,000 view. Is this a lot? Well, this is what is expected, really. And actually, some researchers do dispute this, the effectiveness as such. But this is interesting. An older experiment that was done at eBay, they stopped advertising because the claim was that per dollar advertising expenditure on Google, they would earn $12. Nothing happened when they stopped. So correlation is not causation, right? Economists like to talk about selection bias, etc. So that's the thing. Now, perhaps Mr. Schneier is not that wrong when he says that, you know, companies made money before they spied on people, right? So the conclusion here is there are obviously winners. Next time when you hear people talk about, well, we do have to have tracking because otherwise we won't have free services, perhaps you might also think about bias. There is certainly some effect, but it's largely unknown. Even new research claims that it's largely unknown. Now, to finish this up, what could businesses do? This is very general. I won't go over this, except that applying standards and transparency, according to the guys from Princeton, is probably no surprise. And but some people collect tons of data. I mean, people are businesses, but they don't actually know why they collect them or don't know what to do. So they might ask their lawyers and ask, should we or may we do that? And perhaps their question should be, well, why do we have to do that to provide a service? Now, I'll stop here because of time, you could, we are now at the next point, user base, you could do it like this guy. But seriously, I think over time or over, working at some place, having experience in job, it's not so obvious that you're always online as you might think, actually. And some suggestions, I won't go into this, but except that, of course, everyone can indeed build his ecosystem, at least medium term, and do the stuff that is often suggested. And, the good thing about recording this is you can look it up if you want to. This is an example of uBlock Origin. I think it's highly recommended. Mail, we've already talked about external contents, shouldn't be revealed or set to plain text, of course. I think you're the kind of people who know this. Now, instant messenger, another thing. Well, okay, as an old guy, I use XMPP for the last 100 years or so. So that's fine. I mean, and by the way, conversations is quite a good app, text, audio, video, and works fine. Lineage OS is quite easy to install for you, I think. Actually, I made a test, would it work? Something that is really impressive is I have an old device that's 9 years old, and even after Lineage stopped supporting it, there were unofficial builds, and it works really fast. It's an old device, so this is really sometimes a bit amazing. And as a business person, I would perhaps ask, why not supporting local providers of some sort if you can. Nextcloud is another example often cited. Mobile apps, for example, SRF, which is the Swiss Broadcasting, has 8 taxes. Actually, we pay taxes for them, right? And they need 8 taxes, while tax-paid security research group has 0 taxes. So I don't know about weather apps, whether that, for me, weather is weather on both apps. So, yeah. So, final remark. I could probably go into more detail. I could go faster than that. I could go slower. I think it's probably, this whole thing is probably underestimated. That's my thing. But reading more research probably also means that you get a certain impression what they all talk about, those researchers who really know those things. Did you ever read any research about tracking, profiling, and psychological behavior stuff? I don't know, maybe you did. And what are the consequences? I don't know. I think we have fewer answers than questions. So actually, you've been a nice people. Thanks a lot for this, for listening.